So I want to do something very special this morning because I feel that the message that God has placed on our hearts is a very vital one, and it's a message that will help to bring God's plan for us, amen, into fruition. I don't expect to get a whole lot of pats on the back and a whole lot of I enjoy it, you pastor, because I'm preaching about money. And so I do have some surrogates that help me out, take the pressure off of me a little bit. But I just want to have a word of prayer, and I want to share something with you this morning. Amen. Father, we thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient, and you're able to give us, to make all grace. Hallelujah. You're able to release all grace that we need so that we will have sufficiency in all things. Father, we know that you are able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can think or ask. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to start sharing with the purpose of redemption can be narrowed down in a threefold way. What Jesus actually done for us is threefold. He has restored back to us the dominion or the authority that he gave the first man in its entirety. He has completely restored back the dominion that God placed in Adam's hand. Dominion over all of the works of his hands. Everybody say that. The dominion over all of the works of his hand. Amen. So the dominion over your flesh has been restored. That's big news, I guess. Amen. Because the Bible says in the flesh that there's a dwell any good thing. They that are in the flesh can't please God. So if God has restored back you, back to us, the dominion over our flesh through recreating us by giving us eternal life, by putting his life, his nature, and his ability in us, that enables the human spirit, everybody say the human spirit, to control your body and control your mind and your flesh. Amen. So we don't have the I can't help it no more. We don't have no excuse for not being able to restrain ourselves or to live a holy life, because the spirit of the law of life in Christ Jesus has made us what? Free from the law of what? Sin and death. How many believe you're free? Amen. How many know you're free? Amen. How many think you're free? How many have a consciousness of your freedom? Amen. So I'm free. I don't have to do anything the devil wants me to do. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. How many know the power of the flesh has been subjugated? Amen. Has been reduced to naught in terms of having dominion over you, your body, and your mind. Amen. So we have dominion over the flesh. We have dominion over sin, sickness, and demons, the laws of nature. Yeah. Amen. All of the works of God's hands, we have dominion. How many remember Joshua stopping the sun? Sun stood still. How many know Hezekiah got God to turn back the sundial of the shadow 10 degrees? That's control. That's authority. They exercise the same dominion that Jesus exercised on a limited basis because they tapped into the faith and the faith in the Abraham covenant and faith in obeying. They were strictly obedient to the voice of God. That was the secret of those under the old covenant that exercised dominion. Amen. So I just want you to know that we have dominion over all of the works of God's hands. And we have our studied righteousness and righteousness consciousness. Everybody righteous don't have a consciousness of their right standing with God. That has to be built in. You have your spirit has to be educated. Amen. How many know your mind has to be educated by going to school? Amen. School did a pretty good job on some of us. All right, but that was what mind education. All right, but the spirit education helps to develop, cultivate, amen, and get your spirit subservient. Your body and mind and your flesh subservient to your spirit when it's strong. How many know there are great potentials in your spirit when your spirit is real strong? How many remember Samson? How much power he had? That was in his what? That was spiritual power, dominion. How many can say amen?
Amen.
How many know the demoniac, Gadarene demoniac? He was very powerful. His spirit was developed by the devil. Amen. So your devil can what? Exercise great power too. When his power is what? When is instilled, when you program yourself to follow his dictates, you get strong in that realm as well. Okay, the point I'm getting at is that the three areas that we have a breakthrough now are authority and dominion over all of the works of God's hands and all the forces of evil. All right, the second thing is that God has bestowed us the ability to enter into his presence without a consciousness of being inferior or unworthy or unholy, yes. Without fear, without a sense of sin.
Yes, yes.
Amen. That's very powerful. Touch somebody and say, that's very powerful. The ability to come before God's presence in prayer and ask whatever you will according to his will and know that he hears you. Some of y'all don't get it, how vital that is. Amen. Amen. Interest, the power to enter into God's presence and to demand things to be done in Jesus' name. Amen. To direct a prayer toward heaven, to make your petition before the Lord. Bible says you can come boldly before his what? Prone to ask for what? Mercy and grace to help us in the time of need. Amen. Amen. When you're a citizen of heaven, you know, a citizen of America is a person with the rights to whatever rights and privileges that we have as Americans. We have a right to all of those privileges. How many can? A recognized member of a country that get rights and privileges that nobody else can get. That's what a citizen is. I learned that in civics. Amen. So a person in the kingdom of God, you have rights and privileges. You're able to what? To call the things that be not as what they are, all that as they are. Things that be not as though they what were. Amen. So I believe it's the ability to enter into God's presence and exert your rights and privileges. Amen. And to pray prayers that will prevail. The Bible says the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous does what? Avails much. That's a great privilege because it takes that privilege in order for your dominion to work, for your authority to work. That's the reason why we can cast out devils in the name of what? Jesus. That's the reason why we can what? Decree a thing. Amen. We can decree a thing. That's a privilege that nobody else can get but a child of God. How many glad you're a child of God? Recognize. Woo, glory. Recognize a member of the body of Christ that gets rights and privileges that nobody else can get. Amen. So we got great authority because we have access into his what? Presence. We can have bold access. Glory. Hallelujah. We don't have to act second class. We can come before the presence of God. Know that we what? We have our hearing. And God what? Sees our face with joy. Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. All right, now the third thing I want to focus on. Now some of y'all don't understand how powerful prayer is and how wonderful it is to be able to enter God's presence at will. Amen, to glow in his presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bible says in his presence there is what? Fullness. How many got fooled this morning? Amen. How many know that God, amen, God anointed Jesus with the oil of gladness? He passed it on to us. That's the reason why we are the royal priesthood, a holy nation, a glory, a chosen generation, chosen to show forth his glory.
Hallelujah.
Called to show forth the glory of him that has called us out of what? Darkness into this marvelous light. Oh, what a change in me. I am so happy and I am so free since Jesus brought me out of darkness. Hey, into this marvelous light. Oh, sanctified folks used to sing that. Oh, hallelujah, what a great change in me. Amen. He said, I am so happy. Happy, y'all don't look too happy. It's because a merry heart, takes a merry heart to have what? To do good, like a, amen. Make a cheerful countenance, y'all know that. It takes a what? Merry heart. So you can't get much from God if you are downcast, looking sad, looking wise, and otherwise. You won't get much from God. All right. The third thing that we receive is the inheritance, material inheritance. The material inheritance that was stolen from us through disobedience, that was restored back to us through Jesus. The first Adam sold us out. Is that right? Y'all know what I mean? Through disobedience, what? Your inheritance was what? Was taken from you. Amen. But your inheritance has been what? Restored back. That's the reason the Bible says that he has blessed us with everything that pertains unto what? Life. And unto what? Y'all say that back to me. He has blessed us with what? Everything that pertains to what? Life and unto what? Godliness. Hallelujah. Come on, bless your name. Bless his name. Come on, praise him. He has blessed us with everything that pertains unto what? Life and unto godliness. Does that include material gain? Blessings. Jesus became poor so that we, through his poverty, might be made rich. And this is the riches that God has restored back to us. He has blessed us with what? Everything that what pertains unto life and unto godliness. These are material blessings that God has blessed us with. See, Jesus, actually, when he defeated Satan, death, the grave, and what? The spirit of sins, death, grave, and the power of Satan. When Jesus defeated that, that meant that everything that he created in the natural reverted back to us. It was made accessible that touched. How many know that Jesus, whatever he created for the man? It was the crown of creation. What is man that thou art what mindful of him, the son of man that thou what visited him? Thou hast made him a what? A little lower than the angel. And has crowned him with what? Glory and honor. And has placed what? All things under his what? Feet. Amen. How many can say, everything is under my feet? Satan is under my feet. Hallelujah. Glory. So we have dominion. So therefore, we need to be thinking about material. You know, this is the area that I don't think that we appropriate the appropriate faith as we should in the area of finances. It's kind of hard put to find a person that consistently meditate on the provisions that God has made for us materially. Amen. We'll see a show of hands. All right, so therefore, in order to be an heir, how many can say, I'm an heir of God?
I'm an heir of God.
And I'm a what? Joint heir with what? Jesus Christ. That means you have received a great inheritance. And you have to pray the prayer that Paul told us to pray in Ephesians 1, that the eyes of your understanding might be what? Enlightened, so that you might what? Know the what? Hope of his calling and the riches of the glory of the inheritance which is in the saints. Amen. Amen. There's a rich inheritance in you waiting to be discovered. Amen. It comes through revelation. And I'm going to share today how that's going to be discovered. The purpose of money. Started sharing that last week. And I want to call your attention to Deuteronomy. All right, if we ever can get the victory over these finances, a lot of things are going to be released in your life that you have never experienced before. Amen. I want you to look at Deuteronomy 8. It's going to take my time. It says, when thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord, thy God, for the good land which he had given thee. Amen. Beware that thou forget not the Lord, thy God, in not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes, which I command thee this day. Lest when thou hast eaten and are full, and has built goodly houses, and dwell therein, when thy herds and thy flocks multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied, then thine heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, who led thee through that great and terrible wilderness, wherein were fiery serpents and scorpions and drought, where there was no water, who brought thee forth water out of the rock of flint, who fed thee in the wilderness. Now, these are things that God did for Israel, but we probably are experiencing prosperity that is parallel to whatever they have experienced. Who fed thee in the wilderness which with manna, which thy father knew not, that he might humble thee, and that he might prove thee to do thee good at thy latter end. And thou say in thine heart, my power and the might of mine hand hath gotten me this wealth. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he sware unto thy fathers, as it is this day. And it shall be, if thou do at all forget the Lord thy God, and walk after other gods, and serve them, and worship them, I testify against you this day, that ye shall surely perish. As the nations which the Lord destroyed before your face, so shall ye perish, because ye would not be obedient unto the voice of the Lord your God. Okay, now, the first thing I want to say, Deuteronomy 8:18. Everybody repeat this with me. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that what? Giveth thee power to get well, that he may what? Establish his covenant, which he sware unto the fathers, as it is this day. All right. So that is exactly the purpose of money. Mainly to get God's covenant established upon the earth. You know, but many times we don't understand that money represents the sum total of energies, your life, sweat, blood, your wisdom, your mind, and life's blood. And everybody don't want to give up their money and make God first in their life. So I have here, money represents the sum total of one's energy, time, abilities, and one's life's blood, as it were, represented in dollars and cents. So you can see why many times we have problems with releasing our money, because it represents, it's the closest thing to us. It's something that will buy just about anything you can buy. Somebody said that money can get you into every gate down here on the earth, but it won't get you into the gate of heaven. Every gate but the gate of heaven. So people have a tendency, amen, to avoid or to reject or to turn a deaf ear when you start talking about money, because money is the closest thing to what? People's heart. And you can see why, because what? It represents what? All your education. Is that right? That's it. All of your what? Training. Am I telling you the truth? Represent all of your time and energy. Your best hours is spent what? At somebody's workplace, working. So that's what money is. It represents your energy, your time, your abilities, your skill. But remember, it's God that gives you the ability what? To do all of that. Glory, hallelujah. And God wants to be recognized as what? Amen, your source. The scripture says here that when God blesses you, remember to obey him, to obey his what? His laws, his statutes, his commandments. All right, now here is number one. Let me get that straight. Deuteronomy, everybody turn it to Deuteronomy 14:22. I believe that is the scripture I really want. Now, this is a commandment. We are not trying to humiliate anybody today, but we just want everybody to be tremendously blessed this year. Tremendously blessed. And if it means, Jesus said, the scripture says, if we obey and serve him, we'll live our lives in what? Prosperity, and our years in what? Pleasure. All right, now this is the scripture. I want you to turn to Deuteronomy 14:22. This is the commandment. Also, we find the same commandment in Malachi 3. But I want you to turn, and I want you to rejoice and laugh and smile and be merry, because I'm telling you the truth. And I don't want you to, show that long face. All right. Now, a lot of tithers say, well, Pastor Hill ain't talking to me today, because I've been a tither for 20 years or 30 years ever since I've been in Northside. But I believe that many of the benefits of tithing, of those that have tithed, they're not getting the full benefits, because many times we tithe, but we don't what? We don't acknowledge God's word when we tithe. We don't put no what? Confession. We don't say anything. Brother Williams was showing that confession we have here in this manual. See, every blessing that God has made accessible and available to us, it's going to be manifested through, you first got to what? You got to agree with God in your what? Confession for that particular promise and provision to work effectively. How many can say amen? See, y'all want to shout me down. Now, what about this? Father, as Abraham seed and heir of the world, today I will use your power to get wealth, and I believe I receive wealth in every form that you choose to give it to me, including wisdom and faith. This is a prosperity confession. Revelation knowledge and the anointing for increase, gifts and fruit of the Spirit, creative ideas, concepts and insights, houses, land, businesses, contracts, favor, jobs, promotion. So you are throwing this out, Lord, however you want to get prosperity to me, amen, I'm open. You're making your appeal, your confession. How many know you always get what you say? God creates the fruit of your lips. Amen. Proud. The Bible says the mouth of the upright shall what? Deliver them. So you, all of these provisions that God has made accessible and available to you, amen, all of these, the Bible says he has blessed us with every blessing in what? Heavenly places. He has given us everything that what pertain unto life. And all of these avenues are open to get prosperity into your possession. Yes, yes. And I, you know, sometimes people criticize people that what the naming and claiming people. But I tell you, if God name it, I claim it. Glory. And so God said, well, all of these are available to you, but you got to what? Agree with him. Say, Lord, whatever way I receive wealth in every form that you choose. Praise God. How many are with me today? And this confession enumerates many different bonuses, rewards, scholarships, grants, excellent employees, investments, the wealth of the wicked. If I were you, I would name it. And you don't know how many of these, amen, avenues God has. The Bible says, I hasn't what seen it. Neither ear has what heard it, neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has prepared for them that what love him. Amen. See, God wants you to what acknowledge the provisions, and God wants you to what praise him. Glory, hallelujah, for the end results of what you're believing for. All of that is necessary in order for God to bring financial promises and provisions to pass. It just doesn't happen. Nothing happens by itself. Amen. Our confession, our walk with the Lord is a confession. You always end up getting what you what? Confess. What you say. Now, for that reason, God just showed me, I think that people that tithe consistently, laid back and comfortable, I've been tithing for a long time, Pastor Hill ain't talking to me. Amen. But what are you saying with your time? What are you saying? Amen. Praise God. So I just wanted to get that over. Amen. You need to take this prosperity confession out. Amen. And start what? Mixing this with your offerings and your tithe and your offerings. And I believe that you will begin to what? See a big increase. How many want to see increase? How many want to go, how many want to be promoted financially? How many want to go to a different level? Hallelujah. How many know that God has a whole lot of wealth? God is a what? Plutocrat. That means he's very wealthy. Glory. How many can say praise God? If God Amen. The word says, God said, riches are with me. Amen. Praise God. Doable riches. And I believe that God can give us a revelation how we can what? Increase our financial condition. All right. So I'm done with that so far. Hallelujah. Praise God. I don't know how that went over, but amen. It's over. All right. Come on. Deuteronomy 14. What did I tell you? Deuteronomy what? 14:22. Okay, here you go. Thou shalt truly tithe all the increase of thy seed. See, this is a real blessing. Amen. God wants you to what? He doesn't want no poor among us. He don't want none of us living from what? Hand to mouth. He doesn't want any of us, amen, living from paycheck to paycheck. They said the average amount that the average American spends for fruit and vegetable is $1.74 per week. Because what? Most times people say, well, I can't afford fresh fruit. Well, forget about organic. It's just too far out of our range. See, God doesn't want us what to be limited on foods that are not what? Convenient for us. Food that's not going to build our health. Yesterday I was in class and I mentioned, I say that one thing that's actually extra good for your health, very good, is to get a colonic periodically. Amen. And colonic, it costs $55, but it gets out of you contamination and filth and poisons and toxins that's been in your system for years. That's causing just about everything that's bothering you feeds on a whole lot of the toxicity that's in your body, and you can get it out. Tell somebody, say, what is he talking about now? See, God doesn't want us at the bottom end of what? The health issues. God wants us to what? To be what? On top. He wants us to be the what? Head. And he wants not the what? Tail. We don't have to be, I don't think we have to be the bottom, amen, the bottom when it comes to the health issue. I believe that God wants our health to be what? Great. How many can say amen? He can give you enough money, amen, to buy the vitamins. How many can say amen? He can get to give you the money to buy the what? Fresh, raw vegetables and fruit. Even the organic if you choose them. Free range chickens. Anybody know what free range chickens are? All right. All right, so if God says if we obey and serve him, we'll live our life in what? Prosperity and our what? Years in pleasure. Okay, let me finish reading that. And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose to place his name. There the tithe of thy corn, of thy wine, of thy oil, of thy firstlings, of thy herd, and of thy flocks, that thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always. So, tithing helps you to fear the Lord. That's how you really begin to get established in your walk with the Lord, by what? Fear. The Bible says, blessed is the man that feareth the Lord. This is Psalms 112:1. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord and delighteth greatly in his commandments. See, tithing is a commandment. And he says, the man that delighteth greatly. Amen. Y'all really are delighting today? All right, Malachi 3. Let's go to that scripture. Now, these are scriptures that commands us to tithe. These are commandments. These are things that God wants to even get over to us, because they are very essential in establishing the fear of God. It's the way that we honor God. It's the way that we show God that God is our source. All right, Malachi 3:10. Everybody together, let's read that quickly. 3:10. Hallelujah. Bring ye all the what? Now, this is a commandment now. This is the what? Bring ye all the tithes into the what? Storehouse, that there may be what? Meat in mine house. Prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive. All right, verse 11. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your what? Ground. Neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, said the Lord of hosts. Now, that scripture shows that tithing helps to protect your harvest. Yes. Amen. It keeps the devil from what? Messing with your money. Yes. Bringing all types of what? Hindrances. Yes. Amen. And barriers and all types of worries and anxieties when it comes to your money. God protects, amen, your money. That's what tithing does. And also, the second part, your vine, that means your children, shall not cast her fruit before their time. In other words, your children will not be what? Amen. Subject to what? Satan's plot, sicknesses and diseases and whatever schemes that the enemy wants to come up with, your children will not be subject to that. In other words, it protects that your children will live out their what? Lifespan. Yeah. Amen. Who wouldn't want that? Yeah. Hallelujah. How many can say praise the Lord? Oh, yeah. I see y'all getting happy right now. So you're commanded to tithe. I just gave that to you. You're commanded. Tithing is teach you to fear the Lord and to always put God first in your life. That's what tithing teaches you. How many glad that you're learning your lesson? Or you want to learn your lesson? All right, come on, stand on, fellas. Amen. Raise your hand if you think, amen, if this is a lesson you want to learn, amen. Say, Lord, thank you that I want to learn the lesson. All right, now that's the commandment to tithe. Now, 11:25. Oh God, my gosh, for Lord, my time is shundalabahushundalabashat. Tithing is recognizing God as the source of all that we have. Quiet as a pinch. Now you can use tithing to get healed if you do it or do it the right way. God said that blessed are they that consider them poor, that the Lord will deliver them in the time of trouble. You can put those scriptures on God whenever you come down with any sickness. Ain't that good? Doesn't Psalms 112, if you would read those 9 verses, say that when a person is generous, when a person disperses to the poor, when a person lendeth, a good man lendeth. That means that what? He give tithe and offerings. That's how you lend to God. The Bible says he will be in everlasting remembrance. His righteousness endureth forever. His heart will be forever fixed and established. You won't be wishy-washy in your faith, and you won't be afraid of evil tidings. Wealth and riches shall be in your house. The generation of the upright shall be what? Blessed. Light shall rise in darkness. God give it to a man that is good. Ecclesiastes 2:26. God give it to a man that is good. Wisdom, knowledge, and joy.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory. Oh boy, oh boy, ain't too much joy in here today. But yet, tithing is recognizing God as your source. Hey, How many know that God wants to be recognized? I'm the source. Every good and perfect gifts come from me. Everything that pertains unto life and godliness, I've given it to you. I'm the author. I'm the what? Finisher. How many want to learn God's way of blessing you? Yes. The man's way, amen, is getting rich quick. Amen. The more, if I take from God and invest it, I'll accumulate wealth a lot faster. But the Bible says, he that through usury and unjust gain increase his treasures. He increases his treasure and lays it up for the man that is good before God. The man that will help pity on the poor. Amen. Hallelujah. Well. This is not going over so good, but I'm just going to keep hammering it because I feel 2 Corinthians 3:5-6. I want you to just turn there. Amen. 2 Corinthians 3:5-6. Tithing is recognizing God as the source of all that we have. Amen. I didn't know I could have so much joy preaching tithing. That's the reason why I stayed away from it too long. Amen. I thought people would what really begin to what? Amen. Frown and moan and groan. Glory. Now, by the way, tithing is 10% of your gross income. Everybody know that? It's not what's left after the credit union get through with you, after your car payment comes out, after your investment funds, amen, are what? Extracted. Amen. It's a gross. Amen. Bible says, no wonder the scripture says, so evil I've seen under the sun, namely riches, kept for the owner to his own hurt. All right. Sister Hill, are you? I'd like for Sister Hill to be here on Sunday because, amen, if nobody ever said, Pastor, you did a good job. When I don't do good, you know, sometimes she kind of hit him or around a little bit. But most times he sells a good message. Yes. And she's my number one fan. If nobody say, if everybody just walk past me. That's what they do when I preach like this. They walk past you. Like they don't see you. But I'm trying to teach y'all how to get rich. I mean how to get wealthy. Not for your personal benefit. Amen. But it's what to establish the kingdom of God. That's what God want all men save and come to the knowledge of the truth. After they get saved, amen, you got to what? You got to what? You got to teach them, educate. You got to what? Amen. Cultivate their spirit. You have to build them up. Yes. And it takes lights and gas. Everybody can say amen. Insurance and what? Boy, I mean, so many things you have to pay when you operate in a church like this. Just like the man came out this week to spray the buildings for bugs. Amen. $125. Money like that is not even in the budget. Amen. So we're trying to get everybody, amen, obeying God so we won't have to be what? Trying to what? Make it from what? Month to month. From year to year, amen, every 3 months, crisis, amen, the church growth crisis hit us. All right, Sister Hill, help me to read that, 2 Corinthians 3:5-6, okay, what does that say? 2 Corinthians 3:5-6.
Alright,
not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. If you're functioning on a job, If you are drawing a Social Security check, if you are drawing a retirement check, if you're in the business, if you are earning money through investments, whatever way God has blessed you to earn money. The scripture says, our sufficiency is of God.
Yes.
Who's the author and the finisher of your faith? Who's the one, amen, the Bible says, every good and every perfect gift comes from above. From the what? Father of lights, with whom there is what? No variableness, neither what? Shadow of turning. If God be for us, who can be what? I guess if he didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely gives us what? All things. Every good and perfect gift comes from what? Above. He gives you the air to breathe. Amen. The Bible says God has, amen, a good man. A good man. God give it to a good man. What? Wisdom, knowledge, and joy. It all comes from God. And we ought to be praising God for the ability, what? To even, amen, to be able to, what? Return back to God the tenth part. He doesn't ask us for all 10 parts. He only asked us only for what? 1/10. Amen. Amen. We all just be what? Happy. Y'all smile. Merry heart doeth good. Well, like a medicine. Merry heart makes a what? Cheerful countenance. You ought to be glad that God just limited to what? Just the 10th part plus the offering. Amen. That's the reason why Israel, glory, were commanded to bring all types of offerings, because God wanted to teach them to cherish the spirit of liberality. He wanted to teach them to be generous. Yes. Because the Bible says that, praise God, the liberal soul shall be what? Made fat, and he that watereth shall be what? Watered again. Cast your bread upon the water, and the Bible says, amen, after many days it will what? It'll come back. All right, praise James 1:17. Everybody together, James 1:17. Glory. I might keep y'all here another hour today. Praise God. Hallelujah. James 1:17. Hallelujah. Well, I'm getting an anointing. That's the first time I ever remember getting an anointing on tithing and offerings. Now, some of y'all have been tithing a long time. Amen. I want you to understand that you need to really begin to get your act together, because God wants to increase you a lot more. A lot more. You can sow against unexpected circumstances. Is that right? You can sow against things to come that you don't know anything about. Hallelujah. Abraham sowed. God showed him his future. Everything that will transpire in his life and through his seed. Abraham sowed. David sowed. When the plague killed 70,000 people because David had sinned by numbering Israel. The only thing that stopped the plague, David, he offered a sacrifice. And the plague stayed. Praise God. Hallelujah. Come on, James 1:17. Somebody read that for me. All right, James 1:17. Every what? Every what? And every what?
Perfect gift is from above. And from above. With whom is no fear.
Tithing is recognizing God as the source of all that we have, all that we love and cherish, our time, our energy, and ability. Amen.
Amen.
I got tithing is an acknowledgement of ownership. God is owner of all, and we are only stewards or trustees over our human estates. I want to get into that. My time, All right, faithfulness and tithing is perhaps the greatest test of our stewardship because the natural man is more inclined to desire money more than any other commodity that we have to deal with. Okay, I'm going to do the last one here because tithing helps to protect us from covetousness and greed, which God hates. Amen. Malachi 3:8, withholding tithes and offerings, God called those robbers. See, tithing protects you from covetousness and greed. God really hates that. Take somebody and say, what is he talking about? In other words, using God's money to do your own business. Using God's money to pay bills that you have, amen, with God's money. Praise God. Everybody can say praise God.
Praise God.
All right. Some don't see that as a sin. You know, we kind of water down everything now. Amen. That's the reason why we're so busy being broke. All right. Malachi 3:8, the keeping of money, which belongs to God, is the Bible says God calls them robbers. Amen. How many gonna pray for me? It's Malachi 3:8. Put it down, Malachi 3:8. God called what? Robbers. Rob money that could be used for the kingdom to help to rescue, deliver, get people delivered and saved, and to get them established. Amen. And that money is going for your own personal use. That's what we'll mean. Okay, Ecclesiastes 5:13. God calls it a sore evil under the sun, namely riches kept for the owner to his own hurt. Amen. Ecclesiastes 5:13. Everybody says sore evil. All right. So hallelujah. I've seen under the sun. Sore evil. I've seen under the sun. What? Namely riches kept for the owners thereof. To their own hurt. Okay, how many gonna pray for me? So Pastor Herb can get through. See, y'all did your thing until 10:45, so I'm doing it, man. All right. Ancient sin, he's coveted after what was forbidden of God in Joshua 7:19-26. He coveted when God clearly said, everything, go into Ai and destroy everything that's there. And Achan saw something that he wanted to hold on. That Babylonian, beautiful Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold. He took that for his own personal. God said what? No, no. Go and what? Uh-uh. You don't partake of the accursed. God said destroy it. That means what? It's supposed to be what? Destroyed. And not kept for your own personal what? Use. You know what happened? The lot was cast, fell on Achan, and he was stoned to death. He and his whole family and all of his possessions and all of his cattle, everything that he possessed. Amen. They were destroyed. Romans 2:21-22. The Bible says he coveted. I mean, that's what he said. He coveted for what was forbidden. All right, there's some questions asked in Romans 2:21-22. I want you to read those questions. Amen. And this is the sin of sacrilege. Okay, let's read Romans 2:21-22. Now, the reason why I'm doing this is because this ministry is only going to come to its glory, to its fullness, and fulfill its purpose. Amen. Through people supporting the work of the Lord and people, everybody, actually obeying God and actually what? Tithing and giving. This is God's way of supporting and establishing a work that will benefit you as families and benefit this neighborhood and benefit even those that we're going to be coming into contact with. Amen. It's going to take what? Amen. Now, if these lights weren't on, y'all wouldn't be able to see what I'm talking about here. Y'all keeping up with me? You wouldn't be able to see what I'm doing. All right, Romans 2:21, 22. Okay, Sister Hill, help me read that. Okay, there it goes, okay? Thou therefore which teachest another, teach thyself. Teachest thou not thyself? See, sometimes we can teach big. You know, if I teach tithing, I'm gonna tithe. I guarantee you, we probably be one of the highest contributors of this ministry. And I'm not gonna teach you one thing and do another. And I'm not gonna steal God's money. I don't have anything to do with it. T would think I'm crazy if I said, I'm gonna handle the money this week. She said, are you crazy? Amen. I have a little reluctance even going to her for things that I need because I know how the tithing is what, up and down. Okay, so we don't want to get into the habit of what, teaching one thing and what, living another. Be true to thyself. Praise God. If I ask for a church growth project of 1,000 or whatever, I'm the first one to do it. Amen. Y'all really praying for me, I can feel it. All right, let me go on. Thou that preachest a man should not steal, does thou steal? Thou that says a man should not commit adultery, does thou commit adultery? Ooh, glory. Thou that abhorrest idols, does thou commit sacrilege? Sacrilege is taken from the temple, taken from God, that which is due him, and directed that toward your personal benefit. To pay your insurance payment, to pay your car note, to pay your house note, put gas in your car. Glory. Take from God to meet your own personal obligations. Amen. That's what sacrilege is. All right, I'm almost done. 1 Timothy 6:19. Let's turn there and I'm gonna be done. I'm not doing this to condemn anybody, but we wanna free you up. We want you to get moving in a realm where God's blessings can come on you and overtake you. God wants you blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed in everything that you put your hands to. But first things, amen, is first. Amen. The Bible says through humility and through Proverbs 22:4. I can remember that. Through humility and through, I'm going to keep on saying. Through humility and what? Proverbs 22:4. I'm stalled there. Proverbs 22:4. Through humility and what?
Fear the Lord.
All right. Our riches.
And honor.
I'm gonna say that again. Proverbs 22:4. Through what? Humility. That means submitting to God's way. In other words, humility is retiring from your way, and what? and doing things with God's way. Ooh, glory, 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 glory. Through humility and the fear of God are what? Riches. What else?
Honor.
And what else? And life. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Moving on. 1 Timothy 6:9-10. We're going to have a good church when people get on, amen, get in obedience. How many can say amen? We're going to have a good church. God will start what? Amen. Giving us boldness and confidence. Bible says if your heart condemn you, God is greater than our hearts and he knows what all things. Amen. If your heart condemn you not, how in the world can you withhold from God and have a clear conscience? Somebody lay hands on me, buddy. If your heart condemn you not, then you have what? Confidence toward God, and you can ask whatever you will, and the Bible says what? God will what? He will respond. Amen. A heart void of all offense toward God and man. That's what God wants. How many can say amen?
Amen.
He wants you to where you can get to prayer through. I mean prayers with concerning finance. You like if you can get every prayer through except finance prayers. Amen. But I believe that, priest, once we can get in line and get in order with God's word, I believe that God is going to turn the table. And I believe that as we begin to confess the word of God, all of the provisions that God has given us concerning our giving, confess those admonitions that pertain to the blessings that God promised to pour out on you. When you give to the poor, when you begin to tithe and give out of the abundance of the things that God has blessed you with. 1 Timothy 6:9. This is a long haul, but once I can get past these, amen, these reasons for tithing, it'll be clear sailing, because I really want to go to prosperity. I mean, the transfer of prosperity from the sinner to the believer. I mean, prosperity transfer. How many can say amen?
Amen.
From the...
Yes.
Woo, glory, glory. All right, let's do 1 Timothy 6:9-10. Amen. 1 Timothy 6:9-10. But they that what? All right, for the love, everybody, for the what? All right. Well, I guess that's enough of the negative stuff. Right? I guess y'all call that negative. Praise God. But these are the things that will set your soul free. These are the things, hallelujah, will get you in a position, because God said, if you shall obey and serve me, you spend your days. How many want to spend your days in prosperity? And your years in what? In pleasure. Praise God. How many can say amen? I want you to sit on your feet. I haven't finished all of the reasons why tithing is so important, but I got to two or three of them. Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. If you receive this truth today, and I want to admonish all of the tithers and those that contribute frequently to the Truth Growth Project, I just want to thank you for your efforts. But I do want you to add to your giving, listening to the heart of God, because I believe that God wants to speak to our hearts about our giving up and above our tithe that we normally, amen, give on a consistent basis. Hallelujah, hallelujah. But I want you to begin to add to your giving and your tithing words God's promises. The Bible says, call God into remembrance concerning the things that I have promised. Command thou me. See if I won't open the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that you will have room to receive. But for every promise and provision that God has made us concerning our giving, we ought to be what? Confessing that. Agreeing with God. Saying those things over and over until those things began to become reality. When they become reality in our spirits, then it will bring a dimension of joy. And that joy will be translated into faith for believing that those things that you have believed for, hallelujah, you're going to see those things materialize in your life. Come on, my son. Father, today we want the best for every member. Lord, this is not a message to condemn anybody. This is a message to lay out the truth and to show verse by verse your will concerning us to prosper. Lord, you said withhold, amen, not good from them to whom it is due. Withhold not good from them to whom it is due when it is in the power of thine hand to do it. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you today. I heard your word. I say, yes, Lord, I will obey because I know that my blessing depends on my obedience. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the provisions you have given us, the opportunities that you have given us to tithe, because if you hadn't given us anything, we wouldn't have anything to give back to you. Lord, we thank you that every good and every perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Father, because you have blessed us with every blessing, you have given us of everything that pertains unto life. Lord, it's a joy for us to be able to return and give back to you the tithe and even an offering up and above that which you have blessed us with. Father, we give you praise. We give you the glory now in Jesus' name. Father, give me the grace, whatever I need to do. Lord, help me to reorder my business. Lord, you said that in Psalms 112, that you would, hallelujah, guide our affairs with discretion. Lord, you said wisdom, receiving light in the midst of darkness, we'll be able to guide our business with discretion. That means that we'll make right decisions. We'll choose to do the right thing, make the right choices, and put you first and honor you, make you our source. Lord, we thank you because we want to be, as you said, in your everlasting remembrance. Father, we give you praise. We give you the glory now in Jesus' name. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody, turn around and tell someone, hallelujah, hallelujah, I'm going to obey God. Tell them initially. Tell someone, I'm going to obey God. Tell somebody, I'm going to obey God. Hallelujah. If I teach tithing, I'm going to tithe. I guarantee you, we probably be one of the highest contributors to this ministry. And I'm not going to teach you one thing and do another. And I'm not going to steal God's money. I don't have anything to do with it. You would think I'm crazy if I said, I'm going to handle the money this week. She said, are you crazy? Amen. I have a little reluctance even going to her for things that I need.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, life. I worship you.